The toughest animal on earth. Now, what do you think the toughest animal on earth is? Could it be the tiger? Tiger's a pretty tough animal, isn't it? The honey badger was mentioned, and that's a tough animal. It's true. We'll look at one of his semi-cousins in a minute. But some people might think it's not the tiger, but instead it's the bear. And what kind of a bear is this?
Grizzly.
It's a grizzly bear. That's right. They're pretty ferocious, aren't they? But it's probably not the grizzly bear, but the toughest animal on earth might be the elephant. But you know, I didn't say the strongest animal on earth, did I? If I was probably polled on this before I read this, I might have thought, no, it's not the elephant, it's the wolverine. A little lot like a honey badger. Pretty tough dude, pound for pound. But when we're thinking of something that's tough, we're thinking not necessarily the strongest, not the biggest, maybe not the smallest, but we're thinking about something that can survive under difficult circumstances, with few resources maybe.
A cockroach
is pretty good guess, but I tell you, it's not nearly as tough as the toughest creature in the world. The toughest animal on earth can withstand cold almost to absolute zero. In fact, they've subjected one of these creatures to only like 1 degree above absolute zero, and for a short time it survived. But you put it down maybe 200 degrees below zero, it's just fine. It can stand heat over 300 degrees Fahrenheit. Over 300 degrees Fahrenheit. It can withstand extremely low pressure of a vacuum and also high pressures, more than 1,200 times atmospheric pressure. Isn't that something? This tough animal can survive in a dry state for nearly 10 years, and some have survived at least partially over 100 years. They can withstand 1,000 times more radiation than will kill an elephant. The toughest animal on Earth has lived in the vacuum of space for 10 days, and then has come back to Earth, lived just fine, and reproduced healthy offspring. The toughest animal on Earth is only 0.5 millimeter long. So who or what is this creature? Are you ready? It's the tardigrade. The tardigrade. It's also known as the water bear or the moss piglet. That's right. They are plump, they're waddly, and they like to suckle moss. And they're even cute. And that's why they're called the moss piglet. Not all they do is suck the water out of moss. They must get a few nutrients from it. But they're just tiny little creatures. But they are extreme creatures. They can withstand extreme situations. They can live under almost any condition, including in the vacuum of outer space. They put these things out of the airlock in the space shuttle, let them be exposed to everything in outer space, bring them back in 10 days later, and they still alive and doing well. They can live under almost any conditions. Now, sometimes we think in our lives that the going is getting a little too tough. Right? We think things are hard sometimes. I remember when I used to play basketball, our coach said, now look, guys, when the going gets tough, the tough get going. Right? So, friends, the truth is that we're not too tough. But we have a God who is almighty. And the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 13, there hath no temptation taken you, but such as is common to man. But God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape, that you may be able to bear it. In other words, what he's saying is that there's no temptation God's going to ever allow you, except he's already provided the grace for you. Isn't that nice? And so I just like to say that God helps the tardigrade, and he can help us too. Isn't that something? He can help survive. Do you think he thinks about these little things? Well, the Bible says there's not a sparrow that falls except our Father knows. He says we don't lose a hair of our head except the Father knows. I think he knows about these little creatures, these little water bears, these little moss piglets, and he knows how to care for them. But they are unique and beautiful little creatures. I know that beautiful is in the eye of the beholder here, but really, truly, beauty is in the eye of God. God's made a beautiful little creature here, and I'm thankful for it. And our study today is the best kind of apples. I know Brother Leon's going to like this study. It's going to be one that he's really interested in, because we're going to talk about apples today. The best kind of apples. And I like apples, and I think you do too. Do you know that one of the most favorite and common, most commonly mentioned apple is the Pink Lady from Western Australia. One of the best known modern apples, the Pink Lady, is actually a trademark name for the variety more correctly known as Crisp Pink. Its parentage comes from the Golden Delicious, crossed with the Lady Williams, and originates from Western Australia. It was introduced in the later part of the 20th century and was developed by John Crisp, and that's why it's called the Crisp Pink. But a lot of people know about the Red Delicious. It was developed in Iowa. We hear about them coming from Washington State all the time, but it was actually developed in Iowa. Probably one of our favorite apples in this area is called the Golden Delicious. It was developed in West Virginia, by the way. Another apple that was developed in West Virginia and came from West Virginia and probably was a parent to the Golden Delicious, Grimes Golden, the Grimes Golden apple. It has a sweet flavor. It's a good keeping quality apple and it's widely planted during the early part of the 20th century. We don't see too many of them today. But another apple that we do see a lot of today is called the Gala apple. It's developed in New Zealand. It's one of the most widely grown apple varieties with a sweet, pleasant flavor, and it has good keeping qualities. Another apple you probably have heard of is called the Jonna Gold. The Jonna Gold is a very popular commercial variety with good flavors. It inherits many of the good qualities of its parents. That would be the Jonathan and the Golden Delicious. This was developed in 1943 in New York, just so you know. Now, Leon, there's another apple you like really well. What's that apple?
The Honeycrisp
apple, which was developed in Minnesota. It's designed to be an apple that survives cold weather pretty well. It's a very sweet apple also, and it's one of the most cold hardy apple varieties. Now, we've seen some apples that we're very familiar with, but not the most familiar apple that people recognize on sight more than any other apple. Do you know what apple that might be? It's not the Macintosh.
Granny Smith.
The Granny Smith. More people will recognize and know the variety of a Granny Smith apple than any others. The most instantly recognized of all. And perhaps Australia's most famous export developed in the 1860s. Now, a relatively new apple is called the Jazz. The Jazz was developed in New Zealand, and it's proof that supermarket apples are no longer bland and boring. Jazz has a crisp flavor and superb, rich pear drop flavors, they call it. I like Jazz apples. They're very nice. I've tried them, and I appreciate them very much. Now, we have some more apples today we could look at. We don't have time to look at them all. We could talk about the Fiji apples, the York Imperial apples, the very tart wine sap apples. But, you know, I found out there's an apple that I'd like to try. It's called Allen's Everlasting, and it comes from Ireland. And it's called this because it's such a good keeper apple. It's an old variety from Ireland, and as the name suggests, it's a good keeper. Well, we mentioned the Jonathan, another American classic earlier. The Macintosh was mentioned, and we like Macintosh apples. They're nice. But I want to tell you about the very best apple. It's found in the book of Proverbs, chapter 25, and verse 11. So turn with me to Proverbs chapter 25 and verse 11. A word fitly spoken is like apples of gold in pictures of silver. The Revised Version says, like apples of gold in baskets of silver. Isn't that pretty? Words fitly spoken. Words spoken at the right time, in the right way, in the right manner. They are like apples of gold in baskets of silver. Now, how many of you like fragrant things? You know, an apple blossom is one of the most beautiful fragrant things, isn't it? We like things that are fragrant. In the book, In Heavenly Places, be fragrant in your words. Be fragrant in your words. Remember that you are either a savor of life unto life or of death unto death. Let us be as fragrant flowers. Let the love of Christ pervade your lives. Let your words be such that they will be as apples of gold in pictures of silver. Friends, today I want to talk to you about words. Because the way in which believers speak should reflect their calling as Christians. Christian speech should be sincere. It should be godly. And above all, it should be honoring to God. And I believe that it can be, friends, if we have Christ living within us. Let's talk first about the desire for godly speech. We should desire, and we should even pray for good speech, that we might have it. You know, at the end of our prayer, we sing this soft little song, "Hear Our Prayer, O Lord." You know, hear our prayer. Incline thine ear unto us. We're asking Him to help us. In Psalms 19, there's a very similar prayer. Psalms 19 and verse 14. David says, "Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer." For our words to be acceptable, our thoughts, our meditations have to be acceptable first, because the words are simply a reflection of what comes out of our heart, aren't they? And so we need that. We need that in ourselves, and it should be something that we of ourselves desire. In Psalms 39 and verse 1, "I said, I will take heed to my ways, that I sin not with my" what? "Tongue. I will keep my mouth with a bridle while the wicked is before me." You know what a bridle does? Bridle has a purpose on a horse, doesn't it? It helps to direct it. It says, "I'm going to put a bridle on myself, on my tongue, so that when I'm around the wicked, especially when I'm provoked, when others are difficult, when they are accusing me, when they are putting me down, this is what I'm going to do," he says. He says, "I'm going to do this." Well, if we turn to James chapter 3, we see similar language. James chapter 3, and we begin in verse 2. He says, "For in many things we offend all. If any man offend not in word, the same is a perfect man, and able also to bridle the whole body." Verse 3. "Behold, we put bits in the horses' mouths, that they may obey us, and we turn about their whole body." Now remember in the Psalms, we read about the bridles. Now we have the bits. They go together, don't they? That's right. Verse 4. "Behold also the ships, which though they be so great, and are driven of fierce winds, yet are they turned about with so a very great helm, whithersoever the governor listeth. Even so the tongue is a little member, and boasteth great things. Behold how great a matter a little fire kindleth." And the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. "So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body, and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beasts, and of birds, and of serpents, and of things in the sea is tamed, and hath been tamed of mankind, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be." And again, they don't have to be. Let's go back to the book of Psalms. Psalms 141 and verse 3. "Set a watch, O Lord, before my mouth. Keep the door of my lips." Isn't that a prayer? He's making a prayer. He's asking God to help him. He says, "Set a watch, O Lord, before my mouth. Keep the door of my lips." And so for ourselves, friends, we should be desiring that God will help us to control our expressions, the things that we say and the way that we say them. It is vitally important. And we should desire and we should pray, friends, also, as the Apostle Paul did, for good speech in others. That's right. In Ephesians chapter 4, I want you to notice some interesting things here. If we turn to Ephesians chapter 4 and begin in verse 29. "Taper down on corrupt communications out of your mouth." Is that what it says? It doesn't say that? "Let just a little corrupt communications proceed out of your mouth." It doesn't say that either, does it? It says let no corrupt communications proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption." Let me just stop there for just a minute. We talk about this seal of God issue. It's a pretty important issue, isn't it? But here it says, "Grieve not the Holy Spirit by which you are sealed unto the day of redemption." And the context of not grieving the Spirit of God is by not having corrupt communications, but rather speaking good, edifying things. And then in verse 31, it says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice. He says, let all bitterness. Now, when you think of something being bitter, we don't find it usually a pleasant experience, right? Sometimes we like a tart Granny Smith apple, but we don't like things bitter. What would be the opposite of something that's sort of bitter?
Sweet.
Sweet. We might like something sweet. But this word bitterness, it means sharp words. Sharp words. Not sweet words. You know what I mean when I say someone spoke sharply to you? That's what this means. And we have been told in Child Guidance, page 147, by the way, I want to just stop here. I want to tell you this is one of the most wonderful books that any parent could ever have. The book Child Guidance. Every parent should have a copy of this book because it is so full of practical, everyday counsel from the Scriptures. It says in this book, pleasant, cheery words cost no more than unpleasant, moody words. Isn't that so true? How much does it cost to speak cheerful, pleasant words? Do you disdain to have harsh words spoken to you? Remember that when you speak such words, others feel the sharp sting. They feel this bitterness, this sharp sting. Parents bring practical godliness into the home. Angels are not attracted to a home where discord reigns. Educate your children to speak words that will bring sunshine and joy. And friends, I want to tell you, the best way we can educate our children or educate anyone else is not by our own words in teaching them per se, but it's in our actions, the way we speak our words in everyday life. It's not just simply saying to our children, now you've got to speak softly. You've got to speak softly. No, it's as you learn to speak softly, gently, smoothly, with pathos, with beauty, then our children can too. He says here, let all bitterness and wrath. And this word wrath could actually mean whirlwind. A whirlwind. Think of a tornado. The Lonina says this, it is a state of intense anger with the implications of passionate outbursts. We're not to have that. We're not to let the passions control us, friends. The spirit is to control the flesh, not the flesh controlling the spirit. He says that we are to put away anger. And this word for anger means impulsive wrath. We are to put away evil speaking. And I found it interesting when I looked up and read this in the Greek, what the word for evil speaking here is. You have already all heard of this name, blasphemia. Blasphemia. Don't blaspheme. Don't evil speak. And then malice. Malice. Have you ever heard the word malice before? There's a very famous line that some of us have maybe heard of. In 1861, this country, our United States of America, went through the beginning of a terrible, terrible ordeal, this war between the states. And in this war, there was hatred, there was bitterness, there was animosity. But we had a president who was one of the greatest presidents that we've ever had. And he was, I believe, put there by God to be there for a time that needed to be done. And yet he knew that the South had to be brought into subjection, but he loved those people. And he loved the black slaves that were there. And he loved those slave owners too. And he said this to close out his second inaugural address. He says, with malice toward none, with charity for all. You know what charity means, don't you? It means love. With firmness in the right, as God gives us to see the right, let us strive on to finish the work we are in, to bind up the nation's wounds, to care for him who shall have borne the battle, and for his widow and his orphan, to do all which may achieve and cherish a just and lasting peace among ourselves and with all nations. Oh, he was a great orator, wasn't he? We know we've heard about the Stephen Douglas and the Lincoln debates, and how great he was in those debates. But friends, he had a way with words. And he had a way to say the words. The Gettysburg Address, one of the greatest speeches ever. Just a few hundred words scribbled on a piece of paper. And I believe that God helped Abraham Lincoln But I believe that our God is no respecter of persons. And this speech he gave on March the 4th of 1865, it could be reflected back again in our lives. I didn't just say in our speech, but in our lives as well as our speech. Let's turn to the book of Colossians chapter 3. Here in Colossians 3, we're going to see, starting in verse 8, some of the very similar words that Paul used where we were just reading from. It says, "But now ye also put off all these, anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy." Remember the word blasphemia? "Filthy communication out of your mouth." So here he's very, very similar to what he's just said, right? But now notice verse 9. He adds, "Lie not one to another, seeing you've put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him." He adds to this, to the filthy communications here, he adds abusive language, foul language. But the most important part is, he says that you put off the old man. You see, friends, we can try to reform our lips. We can try to reform our speech. We can try to be careful. But until the old man is put away and we receive the new creature, the new man in Christ, we're really fighting a losing battle. When I was younger, I could curse with the best of sailors. There was a point in my life I had a very foul language, a foul mouth. I'm sorry to admit to you today. But you know, when Jesus came into my life, it all changed. I didn't have a struggle anymore. Those words just didn't naturally flow out anymore. And God has given me the victory, and I'm thankful for that. In 1 Peter chapter 3, starting in verse 9, he says here, "Not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing." In other words, some minister who doesn't like me, he says something harsh and nasty to me. Do I say something harsh and nasty back? No. "Not railing evil for evil." It says, "But contrariwise, blessing, knowing that ye are thereunto called, that ye should inherit a blessing. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil, and his lips that they speak no guile." Now, what are some characteristics of godly speech in our relationship to God? I want to look at some of those just briefly. And I think one, first and foremost, as we said earlier, is that godly speech should give glory and honor to God. So let's turn to Hebrews chapter 13, and we're going to notice verse 15. It says, "By him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually, that is, the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to his name." Is this God's will for each one of us, friends? Is there anyone here who should be exempt or thinks they could be exempt from this? I don't think that any of us are exempt. We should be continually seeking to praise God. And I'm going to tell you, if you'll start reading the Bible, looking for this theme, you're going to see it over and over and over. And the Bible says that by beholding, we become what?
Changed.
And if we will behold these things, friends, it will indeed change us. But if you read the Bible through, you're going to see this theme over and over. Let's go back to Psalms 34. One of my favorite psalms, by the way. You've heard me say that before. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. It says that if you look at the superscription of the psalm, it says it's a psalm of David when he changed his behavior before Abimelech, who drove him away and he departed. Remember, David was fleeing at one point. He was here with Abimelech, and anyhow, he was driven out. But David was glad he was. It was a good thing for David. He says, "I praise the Lord all time, no matter what happens." Psalms 35 and verse 28. "My tongue shall speak of thy righteousness and of thy praise all the day long." How often? All the day. You mean even when it's early morning and the sun's coming up and the grandmother says to the granddaughter, "Get up, it's time." Or mom says to the boy, "It's time to get up." Praise is going to be on our lips and we're just going to get up and be happy. And when the boss says it's time to get those orders out, we're just going to praise God for it all, right? That's what the Bible says in Psalms 51. Psalms 51 in verse 15. O Lord, open thou my lips, and my mouth shall show forth thy praise. I want to tell you, friends, I believe God expects us to praise Him more. God expects us to praise Him more. There was a lady who called here a few weeks ago. Her name was Mary. She's from North Carolina. She had gotten one of our pieces of literature from someone, and she saw the phone number, and she was in need, and she called. We had prayer with her, and we discussed some of her need, and we actually helped her a little bit. And she's tuned in to a couple of our broadcasts since, but I got a call from her this week. Pastor, I'm in trouble. I've got to go to court. My son-in-law has accused me of trespassing. Oh, it's just terrible. It's terrible. And she says, I don't want to go to jail. They could put me in jail for 20 days for this. And I just didn't know what else to do. It was a bad situation and so on. We listened. We had prayer. And we asked God to work. And God did. And you know, the next day I got a phone call. Oh, praise the Lord, Pastor. Praise the Lord. We won the case. The judge dismissed it. He says, I'm free. Well, that was nice. And I'm thankful we can praise the Lord. But you know what? If she had called me and said, Pastor, I lost the case, I'd still say praise the Lord. Because He knows what's best. There was a time that Paul and Silas were traveling, remember? And they got put in jail in Philippi. And they were singing and praising to God till midnight. In Colossians 3. We were in Colossians earlier. Colossians 3 and verse 17. He says, and whatsoever ye do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. So that's pretty good, isn't it? That's pretty good. This is one of the great characteristics of godly speech. Another that's very important, and it's on my heart a lot this morning, because this is actually, well, I'm going to get off onto a side issue for just a moment, about really what I wanted to speak about today, but didn't feel like it was the most important thing to speak about today, but we're going to be talking about it later, and we're going to be writing about it. But it's found in Romans chapter 10, and verses 9 and 10. If thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Now notice in both verse 9 and in verse 10, it speaks about something that we do with our mouth. That we make a confession, that we make a profession of Christ Jesus. That is important. It's vitally important. And it's one of the great characteristics of godly speech. That we confess Jesus Christ and we accept Him as our personal Savior. You know, there are preachers who hem and haul around all day and they beat the bush. And they cannot be plain that Jesus is the only way. They can't be plain that there is no other way to heaven except Jesus Christ, who says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. But I want to tell you something, friends. There are plenty of people today who are confessing to believe in someone they call Jesus Christ. And He's not the real Jesus Christ at all.
That's right.
It's a false Christ. A false Jesus Christ. But there are people, and I want to tell you, there's quite a move going on right now to get all the churches to come back to the false Christ that the Roman Catholic Church is presenting to the people. There was, on the 21st of January this year, a meeting held in Texas at Kenneth Copeland, the famous Pentecostal Charismatics church. It was held a meeting among leading charismatics, leading people of media and broadcasting. And at that meeting, Tony Palmer attended. And Tony Palmer is an Anglican priest, bishop now, who works for the Roman Catholic Church to help promote the charismatic movement and to integrate the charismatic Pentecostal movement into the Catholic Church. And he had been the week before visiting with Pope Francis at the Vatican. And he recorded a video of the Pope to take back to Kenneth Copeland and these charismatic leaders. And he said, I'm not speaking in English, but I will speak no Italian, no English, but heartfully. He actually spoke his first introduction in English, and then he went to Italian, and they put subtitles into it. But he was speaking about unity. He said, I'm speaking to you as a brother. I speak to you in a simple way. He said, give each other a spiritual hug and let God complete the work that He has begun. And the work that He's begun, that He's talking about, is the work of unification, of bringing us all under one church again. And it says, and this is a miracle. The miracle of unity has begun. And that's what He said there on January the 14th of this year. And then this was brought back by Bishop Palmer. And then after they made this, Kenneth Copeland said, I want you to take a video of me to send back to the Pope. And he began it by addressing him as, Sir, Sir. And this was a pitiful, pitiful situation. The bishop, Bishop Palmer, he was talking to people before he showed the video of the Pope. And he said, you know, he said that that you had for 1,000 years one church, a Roman church. It was Catholic, it was universal. He said, then about 1,000 years ago, you had the schism, the split between the East and the West, and you had the Eastern Church, the Eastern Orthodox Church. He says, 500 years later, you come down to the protest of Luther. Now you have the Protestant churches. And it was all over the issue of how we're saved. We're saved by grace through faith. And he says, you know, the Protestants insisted on using the word alone. And that was what the protest was all over. He says, but now we've signed a joint agreement in 1999, some of you know about this, with the Lutheran Church, saying that we have agreements on this issue of justification by faith, that we believe in justification by faith through grace alone. And the Methodist Church later signed this same agreement. And they're inviting all the churches to sign this. Can't you sign this agreement? Don't you believe in grace by faith alone? And since we all believe the same thing, why are we out here being different churches? We should be one church again. We should be bringing everybody together. Because they believe the reason the world, this is the key ingredient, they believe the reason that the world doesn't find Christianity more attractive is because of all the divisions in Christianity. They're looking for the unity that Jesus spoke about, this oneness that Jesus spoke about. And when we can all be one, then the world's going to flock into Christianity, you see. We'll convert the world. And you know, there's some truth in that. There's some truth in that. But the problem is, friends, they have the wrong Christ. They're the second person of the Trinity. And not only that, and in fact, Tony Palmer went so far as to say, look, he says, the protest is over. There's no protest anymore. Therefore, there's no need for a Protestant movement anymore. There's no need for a Protestant church anymore. We should all come back and be Catholic now. And these people, all these charismatics, are saying amen and shouting and screaming and raising their hands. And they're ready to go, friends. And when he said something to Kenneth Copeland about coming to the Vatican, he said, I will go. I'm available. Reaching across the gulf, aren't we? I'm going to tell you something. These are blasphemous words. These are vile words. These are not the kind of words God wants His people to speak. He wants His people to speak words of truth, and we'll look at that in a minute. Truth and love. But I want to tell you, friends, the Bible is very plain about some of this. And sometimes we have to speak firm words. And Jesus did. In Revelation chapter 2, in verse 6, but this thou hast, that thou hatest the deeds of the Nicolaitans, which I also hate. You mean Jesus could say there was something He hated? If you have a red letter edition, is this a red verse in your Bible?
Yes.
Sure is, isn't it? This is the words of Jesus. Context tells you that too, even if you don't have a red letter Bible. And He says, I hate these deeds. I'm not in agreement with these people. Not at all. In 2 Timothy chapter 4, in verse 14, Paul said, Alexander the coppersmith did me much evil. The Lord reward him according to his works. I dare say that this Alexander the coppersmith may have believed a lot of the same doctrines the Apostle Paul taught. But Paul says, I can't have unity with this man. He's an evil man. And if we turn with me to 2 John, verse 9, inspiration says, whosoever transgresses and abideth not in the doctrine of Christ hath not God. He that abideth in the doctrine of Christ, he hath both the Father and the Son. If there come any unto you and bring not this doctrine, receive him not into your house, neither bid him Godspeed, for he that biddeth him Godspeed is a partaker of his evil deeds. Do you think John was for unity at any cost? Do you think John was willing to unify with people that that didn't believe in Jesus like he did? Absolutely not. Friends, I want to tell you, even if these people believed in the Godhead, like we say we believe, even if that was cured, they still believe in the Mass, transubstantiation. Of course, you know, if you get rid of the Trinity, I probably eventually everything else has to fall. But look here, friends, the protest isn't over just the word alone. It was a key word in the Reformation, that's true. But I'm going to tell you what, the Council of Trent has still not been repudiated. The Council of Trent has still not been repudiated. There is still transubstantiation. There's still prayers for the dead. There's still believing that the dead go straight to heaven or hell. There's still the belief there's eternal hell. I want to tell you, friends, the protest is still on. You bet. The protest is still on. The characteristics of godly speech. How we speak to others. We have to speak about this morning. It should be gentle, gracious, and tactful. In Colossians chapter 4 and verse 6, Paul says, "Let your speech be always with grace, seasoned with salt, that ye may know how ye ought to answer every man." Some of us like salt a little. Some of us like salt a little bit more. But salt makes food nicer, doesn't it? It's not so bland, but he says, let your speech be seasoned with salt. Let it be gentle. Let it be gracious. Sometimes there's a place to speak firm. Jesus sometimes spoke rebukes. We were told that when he did it, there were tears in his eyes. He didn't speak rebukes with a vengeance, with an anger, a hurt that wanted to hurt and destroy people. He wanted to awaken them to repentance. You know, I had this dog, her name's Bun, Cinnabon. And I can just start talking to Cinnabon, and I can pet her, and I can say, you know, you're such a stupid dog. You're just a bad dog. I'm just so disappointed in you. And you know what she'll do? Her tail's just going like this, you know? But if I try to tell her, you nice dog, she's going to cower. It's not just the words we say, friends. Sometimes the way we say words is far more important than the words that we say. Absolutely. And we should have some tact. We should use some tact in the way we talk. And just because you don't say much doesn't mean you always use tact. Sometimes you don't have to say very much at all. Some of you know that President Calvin Coolidge was known at times to be a man of few words. A woman one time came up to him and she said, "President Coolidge, I bet my husband I could get you to say more than two words." And he said, "You lose." That's what I said. He said, "You lose.
You lose."
You lose. But one time he went back to his neighboring Vermont, and his neighborhood in Vermont, and the people there decided that they would recognize his devotion to the old family farm by giving him a handmade rake. There was an orchard there, and he started to expound upon this rake and the fine hickory handle it had, which he believed was very symbolic of the president, sturdy, strong, resilient, unbroken. He handed the rake to Coolidge, and everybody waited for Coolidge's little talk, and Coolidge looked at it, and he said, "Ash." And so I said, "Ash." It wasn't hickory, it was ash. Well, that probably wasn't very tactful, was it? Just said one word. Sometimes we don't need to say much. And we can still say bad things. We can still do better. One of the favorite proverbs of our young people that they were talking in Sabbath school class today was found in Proverbs chapter 15, verse 1. Do you remember what it says? Let's turn back there. "A soft answer turneth away wrath, but grievous words stir up anger." Is that true?
Yes.
Oh, it can't be true. That guy yelled at me, and the only way to get back at him was to yell back. But didn't we read something in 1 Peter 3:9? that when people rend against us, we don't, you know, go tit for tat back and forth and harshness meets harshness. Didn't we read that earlier? It says a soft answer turneth away wrath. I had a nice interesting email this week. I was going to put it up here, but I decided I wouldn't for the sake of confidentiality, but I'll just tell you a little bit about it. But this person wrote me concerning the February issue of OPAS. And in the February issue of OPAS, I was talking about the certainty of the seventh-day Sabbath in the spirit of prophecy. And there were some things that I must have wrote that this man didn't appreciate. And he said, "Don't you know your scholarship?" I could just hear it as I was reading it. Ellen White never said that Saturday is the Sabbath, and she never said Friday is a preparation day. I think you should do some scholarship before you send out things in front of the people and act like you're a teacher. So I wrote back to the brother and I said something like this: "I appreciate that you took time to read the paper, and I thank you for your thoughts. And just so that your experience can be a little more well-rounded, I thought you'd appreciate these quotations." So I put about four or five quotations where Ellen White said Saturday was the Sabbath, a couple quotations where she said that Friday is the preparation day. Have a nice day. But you know what? I got an email back, and it was a very different toned email. It was a very different toned email. Now, I could have... You know, I could have put a growth ear on this guy, those of you who know him. I could have let this guy have it, but it wouldn't have helped him. And you may think from your experience a soft answer doesn't turn away wrath because you tried it once and it didn't work. And sometimes, friends, it doesn't work after one try. Sometimes it has to be tried over and over and over and over again. But if you keep trying it, it works. It does work because God's Word says it does, and I believe it. A proverb that we went over this morning is also close by here in your Bible, in Proverbs chapter 16 and verse 24. It says, "Pleasant words are as an honeycomb, sweet to the soul and health to the bones." I don't know about you, but I like honey. Don't you? And I like the sweetness of honey. And just like we like honey, we like sweet words. And they are health to our bones and they help us. But I want to tell you something, that we need to have pleasant words, but they must be backed up with pleasant actions. I can ask someone, for instance, you know, "Pick up those dirty socks." "I will, I'll pick them up." And they keep saying, "I will, I'll pick them up. I will, I'll pick them up." If they never pick them up, I begin to question the sincerity of their words, right? And so we need to back up our words with actions, with that kind of a life. Our words should be kind. And I like to say here sometimes that the truth is not always kind. We're admonished to speak truth, and we do have to speak the truth, but not always. There are some things that don't always have to be said. The Bible says that love hides a multitude of what? Sins. Sometimes we learn juicy things about our friends or our neighbors or our family, and we just want to go share them with everyone else. And we can always come back and say, "Well, I said it pleasantly, and it was the truth, but it wasn't kind, and it wasn't necessary, and it wasn't edifying." So we need to be careful about that. We want good words. Proverbs chapter 12, while we're in Proverbs. Proverbs 12 and verse 25. It says, "Heaviness in the heart of man maketh it stoop, but a good word maketh it glad." So how many of you want to have a sad heart today? Wouldn't you rather have a glad heart? A good heart? Wouldn't you like your brothers and sisters to have a good heart, a glad heart? Then use good words, pleasant words with them. Words that are edifying, that are instructive. We read about that earlier, but we could read about it again in Colossians 3. Again, we've been in Colossians 3 a couple times. It's a good chapter, by the way. Proverbs 12 is a good chapter. A lot in Proverbs 12 on this issue. Proverbs 15 and others. But in Colossians 3, verse 16, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord." Have you ever walked into a room and someone was working, but they were also singing at the same time? And didn't it lift your spirits? Didn't it encourage you? You know, we're told that often while Jesus was working at the carpenter's bench, that he would be singing. And oh, the beauty, the melody of his voice, the pathos in his voice. Wouldn't you like to hear Jesus sing? You know what? You can sing for Jesus, and people can hear Jesus singing in you, if you will. That's right. Ephesians chapter 4, in verse 29, it says, "Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace unto the hearers." Mm-hmm. Not words that tear down and destroy people. The Bible says that there is a place sometimes for rebuke. There is a place to correct, but it has to be done, friends, in an upbuilding way, in a way that's designed to lift up people and not tear them down. I wear glasses because I just can't see well without them. And I can't read my notes, I can't read my Bible without them anymore. I guess my brother sometimes he does this. Russ, he prints out his notes at font size this big sometimes, so he doesn't have to use his glasses so much. Big font, you know. I guess if I printed them out that big, I could read them some. But I don't usually do that. I have this disease called glaucoma, and it's going to make me go blind if I don't treat it. And I try to take care of my eyes, and I need to take care of them better probably. But the reason I take care of them is because I value the gift of my sight so much. And probably every one of you value the gift of your sight too. But you know, sight is not the greatest gift that we have. Think of your senses, you know? Hearing, smelling, seeing, touching, tasting. What's the greatest gift you got? Your speech. That's right. From Testimonies Church, Volume 6, is found also in Call Porter Ministry. That's where I learned it from. It says, "Of all the gifts that God has bestowed upon men, none is more precious than the gift of speech." Let me pause for a minute, beloved. When we abuse the gift of speech, we are abusing the most precious gift that God has given us. So let's learn to use the gift of speech wisely, beautifully, properly. Continuing, "If sanctified by the Holy Spirit, it is a power for good. It is with the tongue that we convince and persuade. With it, we offer prayer and praise to God, and with it, we convey rich thoughts of the Redeemer's love." And that is the value of that gift for us. This gift should be used prudently. At times, as I mentioned earlier, it has to be restrained. Proverbs 17. In verse 27, "He that hath knowledge spareth his words, and a man of understanding is of an excellent spirit." In other words, sometimes there's a time to spare our words or to hold them back. And we see this among wise people. The people who don't spare their words, they don't demonstrate very much wisdom. And we could look at many other references. Proverbs 15:28, Proverbs 18:13 we should look at because we're right by it here. "He that answereth the matter before he heareth it, it is folly and shame unto him." People bring us an idea, something new or something that we're against maybe in times past, and sometimes we're quick to put them off, but be careful. Hear out the matter. Make sure you hear the matter out properly. But as the old proverb says, think twice before you speak once. Most of the time we speak two or three, maybe four or five times before we even hear or think once. Sometimes we must be prudent and restrained. We must speak truth. Of course we are to speak truth. We're not to lie. We're not to... There was a debate back in around 1804, I think it was. Did you ever hear about the lying Baptists? The lying Baptists? Or the truthful Baptists? There were some Baptists, I think it was in Kentucky. I may have the area wrong. But the issue was that there was a conflict with some Indians, and there was a child that was probably going to be killed, and if they lied to the Indians, the child would be spared. But if they told the truth, the child was probably going to die. And so there was a debate among these Baptists, what do we do? Because some of them said, well, if we tell the truth, the child will die. It'd be better to lie and let the child live. And some said, no, we have to be truthful. So would have you been in the lying Baptists or the truthful Baptists? The Bible teaches that we are to be truthful. Sometimes we may have to be silent, but we can't lie, not even to save life. We should use wise speech in Psalms 37. While you're turning there, I just remind you in Proverbs 12:22 it says, "Lying lips are an abomination to the Lord." Psalms 37 and verse 30. The mouth of the righteous speaketh wisdom, and his tongue talketh of judgment. It takes wisdom to do that. Now, who do you think is our example in all things? Is it the preacher?
No.
Our mother, our father even?
Christ.
It's Jesus Christ. And Jesus had beautiful, pure speech. And he spoke beautiful things. In John chapter 7, it speaks about there was a time that the leaders were going to try to capture Jesus. They were going to capture him, and they sent some of the temple guards out to arrest him. And the temple guards came back empty-handed, and they said, what happened? And you remember what their very short answer was? Never man spake like this man. They weren't hypnotized. I don't want to use that concept. I'm just trying to find some word to express the experiences men had. I mean, they were just enthralled by Jesus. They were overwhelmed by him, by his words, and the way he spoke was where he said, no one has ever spoke like this before. They couldn't arrest him. They couldn't bring him back. The Bible says that he didn't teach as the scribes or the Pharisees in Matthew 7, verse 28 and 29. It says he taught them as one that had what? Authority. And he had authority, friends, because he spoke the words of the Father through the Spirit of the Father. And if we will speak the words of the Father with the Spirit of the Father behind them, we can have authority too. And people will look at us and say, I've never heard this in my life. We were having a series of meetings at Indian Creek on the mark of the beast. Remember those? And there was a man who came up to me after that meeting. He said, I've never heard anything like this in my life. He said, you should be preaching this in every church coming and going up and down this area. I said, you're right, I should. I'd like to. You get me in and I will. But friends, the truth, when the truth is presented with the power of the Spirit, it will speak to people. And I like a text in Luke chapter 4, if we could turn there. And all bear him witness and wondered at the gracious words which proceeded out of his mouth. What kind of words came out of the mouth of Jesus?
Gracious.
They were gracious words. I can just imagine one series of those gracious words was heard by a woman who was taken in the very act of adultery. And they brought her and they drug her in barely clothed position to Jesus. And he said, now the law of Moses says that we should stone this woman. What do you think about it? And Jesus finally, after he got rid of those accusers, he looked at this lady and he said, neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. How could have Jesus said it any better? How could have he said it any more gracious? How could have it helped this woman any more? Neither do I condemn thee, but go and sin no more. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet that the birds hush their singing. That's right. In Acts chapter 4, and verse 13, Peter, John, the disciples have been brought before the council of the Sanhedrin for their faith. They were told basically, shut up. We don't want to hear you anymore. We don't like your gracious words, your good words. It says, and now when they saw the boldness of Peter and John, and perceived that they were unlearned and ignorant men, they marveled and took knowledge of them that they had been with Jesus. The words that Peter and John spoke, even though they were spoken with boldness, were words that could cut these people and help them and try to bring them to conviction. But they took note that they had been with Jesus. And I'd just like to say this, that when we spend time with Jesus, friends, people will know. Because you know why? We're going to begin to speak like Jesus. By beholding, we become changed. And if we will spend time with Jesus, we'll learn to speak like Jesus did. Because he is our example in all things. 1 Peter chapter 2, in verse 22, speaking of Jesus, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his what?
Mouth.
Who, when he was reviled, reviled not again. When he suffered, he threatened not, but committeth himself unto him that judgeth righteously. And this is the man who is our example. And we should be like Jesus. Now, why is all this so important to us? Well, as we said earlier, it makes our life pleasant, and it makes the life of those around us pleasant. But I want to tell you that speech is an expression of our character. Speech is an expression of our character. And if our speech is rough and coarse and rude and unruly, it's saying something about our character, friends. In Matthew chapter 12 in verse 34. Jesus said, "O generation of vipers." Wait a minute. That wouldn't be tactful. Is that seasoned with salt? Well, sometimes, friends, it has to be said that plain. And this was one of those times when divine wisdom knew where to draw the line. "O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart the mouth speaketh. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned." Friends, our words have a lot to do with our character, and they're going to have everything to do with our judgment. And so it's a pretty important issue, isn't it? This isn't just one of those mild pastoral issues that is a nice topic to break up the other issues that we discuss and speak about each Sabbath. This is a salvational issue. That's how important it is. In Colossians chapter 3, in verse 8, "But now ye also put off all these." How many of these? All these. How much of them? All of them. "Anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy communication out of your mouth. Lie not one to another, seeing that ye have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man, which is renewed in knowledge after the image of him that created him." That's the secret, friends. That's the key to having this experience, so that we can stand in the judgment and our words can justify us. God can look at these people and he can look at the rest of the universe and he can say, "Now look here, you see these words? They proceeded out of his heart." And it wasn't just an occasional thing here or there. His words were consistently like this. Her words were consistently like this. And God can justify us before the universe by those words. But he'll also be able to use the words, friends, if we don't follow this text, if we fail to obey this text, he'll use those words to condemn us. They will stand in judgment against us. As Paul said, we condemn ourselves. So what we want today are the best apples. We want apples of gold in baskets of silver. Apples, A-P-P-L-E-S, apples. Think about it. Are my words appropriate? Are my words pleasant? Are my words pure? Are my words lovely? Are my words encouraging? And are my words soft? And friends, if they are, then those words can justify you before God in heaven. And they can make life better for you and better for everyone else around you. May God bless each one of us. Have pure, sweet, soft, pleasant, gentle, good words. Words that are acceptable. And where we need to learn to use wisdom and to hold back some words that shouldn't be said. Right? Thank you for being people who love me today. And I love each one of you. May God bless you lots and lots.